Now we're going to put everything together. I've been showing you all the different components, and now we're going to combine it where we have the instrumental variable component and then also the differencing off. So here, the first outcome that we're looking at here is next year's English Language Arts test. And these are in standard deviation units, so you can interpret them as effect sizes. The first thing that I want to point out is, in the pre-2007 period, what we see is that students who are barely reclassified are scoring about 0.13 standard deviations lower on next year's English Language Arts test than are the students who are just barely not reclassified. That was when the test was not so difficult, right? Then when it becomes more difficult, then we look at the post-2007 estimate, and we see that it's not significantly different from zero. Now, what's particularly important here is when you look at the policy change row, you see that it says 0.166. This tells us, and it's statistically significant, what this tells us is that the change in the difficulty level of the test resulted in a policy change effect, and it removed the negative effect of reclassification on subsequent academic performance on English Language Arts tests. Well, that's if we're looking at just the English Language Arts test, but there's other outcomes that we could look at. We might be interested in graduation effects, graduation outcomes, for example. Now, these are probabilities, and what we see is that in the pre-2007 period, when the test was not as difficult to pass, there was a negative effect of reclassification on graduation, such that the students who were just barely reclassified are graduating at rates that are 9 percentage points lower than students who are just barely not reclassified. Again, what we see is the same pattern where once the criteria were made more difficult, then that there's no effect of reclassification on graduation, just like there was no effect that we could detect on, on English Language Arts performance. But what we see is that the change in the criterion removed essentially what the reclassification penalty on graduation is, so that there's no effect of reclassification on graduation, either negative or positive. This is good because we don't want reclassification to have an effect. If it has a negative effect, clearly that's negative, right? We know negative is negative. If it has a positive effect, that's also not a good thing, because that means that other students who aren't reclassified would have benefited from being reclassified. Okay, so if we think about what these effects are saying, and we put this in the context of the 2011 paper where I laid out a theory of the effects of reclassification and how policymakers would think about that, in the pre-2007 period, where we saw negative effects, we were kind of down here, where there's a negative effect and they have a low threshold. Then they made the threshold more difficult, so in the post-2007 period, we're kind of around a point of point B, where we don't see that there's any positive or negative effect of reclassification. So this is suggesting that once they changed the threshold, it became more of an optimal threshold, where there was neither a negative or positive effect of reclassification. This suggests that there's a smooth transition for students from the English learner setting to the reclassified fluent English proficient setting, and that there isn't any sort of academic disruptions that we can detect with these particular outcomes. There were several different robustness checks that we performed to see if the results were sensitive to any sort of modeling choices, and we found that the results were fairly robust to any sort of specification check that we performed. The results are in the paper if you're interested in them. So the policy implications so far, first is that reclassification can have effects. Now this is important because a lot of times what policymakers do is they want students to be reclassified as fluent English proficient. This makes sense because we want students to be English proficient. That's a positive outcome that we want. However, we need to think though, if we're not transitioning students at the appropriate time, then we might be pushing students into a setting that isn't appropriate for them, either too soon or keeping them in a setting that isn't appropriate for them for too long. So what this work suggests is that we want to actually assess the effects of reclassification policies rather than necessarily saying, let's just keep increasing reclassification rates and not thinking about the consequences of the policies themselves. What the work shows is that sometimes there's positive effects and sometimes there's negative effects and sometimes there's null effects. And this is important to understand too. I don't think we can just generally say reclassification has positive effects or negative effects or there's no effect of it. The effect depends on the context. In some contexts, students are going to be in these settings for too long, and in other contexts, they're going to be in them, they would be removed from them too soon. So we need to think about what the particular services are that are provided to students in each individual school setting, and also think about what the particular needs of students are. And we need to think about where the policy criteria are placed too. So all these different things are interacting together. And sometimes they might produce positive effects, and other times they might produce negative effects. The second point that I want to highlight here is that policymakers can correct misaligned policies. So what we saw with this paper that I just was talking about in LAUSD is that when there was a negative effect with a low threshold, the threshold was made to be higher, and we saw that there was a removal of the negative effect. So this suggests that policymakers have not only a lot of influence in where they set the criteria on the likelihood of reclassification, but they also have a lot of influence on, or a lot of potential to remove negative effects or readjust criteria as needed. Other things could also be corrected too, but we don't study those empirically, so hypothetically things could be changed to shift the effects. The final point here that I want to highlight is the importance of assessment threshold service alignment. And what I mean here is the particular analyses that we performed allow us to see if there's evidence that one setting is better than another setting for students at a particular point in the assessment threshold. They don't tell us necessarily if this is the best possible setting for students. It tells us the average setting for students who are English learners versus the average setting for students who are reclassified fluent English proficient. There could be some better setting for both sets of these students, but we don't know that. But what it tells us is, of the potential settings that are going on for students in a particular school, do we see that there's a smooth transition from one setting to the next at the particular threshold? If we see that there's evidence of a disconnect, then that tells us we need to look deeper to see what might be driving this disconnect and how we could adjust the policies and settings appropriately. So what this work so far does is it provides us with a theory and some evidence on how policymakers can improve transitions for English learners.